Manus flat on the canvas. We are ready to rock and roll. Second round of action. There is a cut on Manus.
Martial art. Yeah.
My man B-Hop got knocked out, dropped out the ring last night.
I need a little judo baby. I need me a little judo baby. And let's do it, Ron. Let's hit me up.
See what they'll do. She got a face for radio.
I've got a face for radio.
That's nice.
Martial arts chat.
Martial arts chat.
Martial arts chat.
Hello, I'm John Boy McElroy, and welcome to the Martial Arts Chat podcast. On this episode, we'll be looking ahead to Cage Warriors 96. It takes place Saturday at the Echo, and we'll be speaking with all the big fighters from that card, including middleweight title challenger and Liverpool's own Luke Chadwick. We'll also be speaking to the main event, Soren and Paddy the Baddy Pimblett, as they set to throw down for the vacant Cage Warriors lightweight belt. Later in the show, we'll be speaking with Severe MMA's Steve Betts. But before we continue, first a shout out to our sponsors. A1 Fight Gear. A1 Fight Gear use the latest cutting-edge boxing gloves for professional and amateur fighters, gym enthusiasts and kickboxers. Local and national gyms in the UK, do yourselves a favour and check out a1fightgear.com. And if you want to get into shape, get back into shape, then go to beastgear.co.uk, use the coupon code MARTIALARTSCHAT and save 15% off your purchases. They've got core sliders, straps and barbell pads, all strength and conditioning programs to suit your needs at all levels. Beast your goals this summer with beastgear.co.uk. Finally, we're also sponsored by MMATakeover.com. For the real MMA rankings, go to MMATakeover.com or like them on Facebook, follow them on Twitter. So to the chat. First up, we travel to Liverpool to speak with Cage Warriors middleweight title challenger Liam Chadwick. Cage Warriors 96 takes place at the Echo in Liverpool, Saturday the 1st of September. Pleased to say we have joining us at this time Merseyside's own The Butcher, Lee Chadwick. Lee, how you doing, sir?
I'm good, mate. I'm good, thank you. Thanks for having me.
Pleasure to have you on, mate. Speaking a wee bit just prior there, saw you in the flesh in Glasgow, but the first thing that came in my mind when I saw you, mate, was how the fuck does this guy make middleweight? It's huge, man. Weight cut and things like that, you're okay with that, are you? It's no.
Everyone says the same thing, but it is, I do cut a lot of weight, but it suits me, it works for me. And I managed to put like on the fight day, it's alright, it doesn't really take too much out of my gas tank. I do like to cut down to 84 from the week of the fights, from 91 to 84. So I fight my fight camp, I go through my fight camp about 97, 98. And then I come down a few kilo each week the last 4 weeks.
So you do it. Aye, that's probably the best way. Do it in stages and then come fight week. Yeah. Get it all nice and levelled. And how's obviously we're still a wee ways out, you've had a wee bit of R&R time over the weekend and stuff, and you feeling pretty good?
Yeah, feel good, yeah. Just bit of training, bit of swimming, sauna, jacuzzi, just recovering from the tough week, but active recovery, so I'm still burning calories, keeping going.
Aye.
Not just having lazy days, to be honest with you, it's all go.
Yeah, fair play, mate, fair play. Let's talk Liverpool, and obviously your title defence was supposed to happen back in February. Unfortunately, you got that knee injury.
Yeah.
Pretty devastating for you, mate, or just as a part of the job?
Yeah, good for mate. It's one of them. And since then, that knee got better. I popped my other knee about two or three times since. Yes. But to be honest with you, it's just one of those things where, after so long of fighting, you'd have these niggles. Even young fighters said that no one goes into a cage without a little bit of an injury somewhere, whether it's a sore hand, wrist, elbow, knees, ankles, whatever. You're going to have a bit of an injury whenever you fight, because you put your body through the extremes, so you can't expect to go through the extremes and be 100% fresh.
Absolutely, man. I mean, it's par for the course for someone like yourself who does MMA. Trying to talk to people doing the podcast thing about, you know, you guys and fighters, and it's like, look, none of these guys are going in without, like you said, without the niggles. It's just, I don't know, do you just get numb to it? Is that how it goes?
That's it, yeah. You bounce back. And it's not the case of, well, not for me anyway, it's not the case of get injured, don't come to training. I put my name in the gym the next day with a bandage on, strapped up, and I'll wrestle, I'll grapple from underneath, and I won't use my left leg. Right. I'll just try and sweep with my right leg and use my arms and try and get top position, keep my leg straight and use my weight. And you just got to work around and find new skills and new tools. Just got to work around it. So sometimes these injuries come at a good time to make you perfect other avenues.
That's a brilliant spin on it, mate. That's a really good attitude to take to it. Aye, definitely. Yeah. I mean, I guess I'm outside as a fan looking in. I'm looking at it thinking, Lee, 2017, what a year for you, mate. You choke out Tommy Quinn. That heel hook on, the heel hook on Andy, I mean, that video goes viral, and you get a Cage Warriors title, obviously, as well, to top off the year. I'm a bit of a sucker for momentum, right? But I'm looking at it going, man, he's had to pull out that fight in February. That's got to hinder things for momentum. Do you buy into that at all?
No, because do you know what? I've had more time to build up on my strength and my cardio and my lung capacity and stuff like that. So even though I had to pull out the fight in February, I never stopped fighting and that's all. Sure. I think the most I had 1 week off and that was it. Nice. So I haven't stopped training since last October when I won the title, and I'm a lot better on the ground than I was now because I've been grappling day in, day out with it through injuries and everything. So my ground work and my boxing have come on a lot since the Victor Chang fight, which you're going to see on the 1st of September.
That's amazing. It sounds like probably a wee bit of a blessing in disguise then. Slows you
could be, it could be, and that's what I say. I always look at the positives. I'm a big believer in positive thinking and the universal mind and stuff like that. So I believe that everything happens for a reason, and I'm going to come in strong, and I'm going to be hungrier on the 1st of September because I was a bit fatigued after last year. Mm-hmm. It was such a good run. But like, by the time I got to Christmas, I just felt drained mentally.
Aye.
So, but I'm ready to fight. I always am ready to fight after Christmas. But I think maybe something out there has said to me, "No, listen, mm-hmm. you need a little rest.
Aye.
You're doing well. Have your time off and come back and keep going." So we'll see. 1st of September, I believe that's my calling to get another good win.
Not a fair play, big man. Let's talk a wee bit about Jonas Belston. The German holds up. A fair few submission victories. He's obviously making his debut, and what I'm thinking is he's stepping into enemy territory, right? You're stepping into this is your backyard.
He is, and he hasn't built up the ranking, so he's lucky, to be honest with you, that he's getting a chance to get this title, because this title usually recommends you to the UFC. So he's lucky he's getting a shot at this title with a climb in the rankings. But to be honest, there was no one else in the Cage Warriors middleweight division that was ready. So I'm all game for it. He's ranked number one in Germany and 8 in Russia. He's well respected fighter. So yeah, he's a good opponent for the title for us.
Should be a great test for you, and obviously Liverpool's a big deal in your life, Lee. Earlier we saw the UFC make waves there with Darren Till headlining, but one of the things it was flooding my Twitter, right, was your fans and your followers, all of them campaigning to get you on that card, mate. Could that have happened? Was that a possibility?
That's what we were trying to do, but they weren't having none of it. They were saying they've got too many people on the middleweight roster, so they didn't want to see. I didn't want to one fight, I wanted the contract. Mm-hmm. So I'm waiting for the contract at the UFC, and what they're saying is on fire at the minute because we've got that many middleweights at the minute. So as soon as there's an opening, you're in. So it's a matter of keeping my nose clean at the minute.
Yeah, I mean, there seems to be a real buzz about UK MMA at the moment. I don't know how you feel.
It's really good. It's really on the map, and it's showing that we've got really high-class fighters from England, Scotland, Ireland, all the UK.
Oh,
is producing really good top fighters now.
And not just the UFC, come calling, we'll get Bellator, you know, they've snapped up, I think it's like something like 22 UK and Irish fighters or something.
Is it 22? Yeah, to be honest, I believe I was offered a contract with them, Bellator or something, but my coach wants to hold out for the UFC.
UFC, that's what your heart's set on, mate. That's it,
that's what we've been fighting for, that's the dream. And no matter what anyone says, UFC is the pinnacle of MMA, isn't it? So.
Yeah.
At the end of the day, aim for the top.
That's it.
And, you know, because no matter what happens, there's always other avenues in the future, but aim for the top.
Oh, I wish you nothing but the best, mate. I hope you get to plant that flag in Everest and the UFC and get it done. Fair play, Lee. Absolute pleasure to get your time on the podcast, my friend. Before I let you go, I just want to give you the floor here to shout out any sponsors, associates, affiliates, anyone you like.
Yeah, definitely. That would be great. I'd like to say a big thanks to PNI Supplements in Liverpool, and actually worldwide online. Kids in Bloom Nursery, Lux Nutrition. Sorry about the M's in between. I'm just trying to
put you on the spot.
I'd like to say thanks to Lewis Williams and Helen Watson and Co. Helen's Watson and Co. Hairdressers. Who else is there? There's XS Mouthguard. There's Luciano Fashion. I've got quite a few, haven't I?
You've got a lot of love, mate.
There's Peach Elite Sportswear. Yeah, and Canavape CBD. Canavape CBD. That's it.
Awesome stuff, lad. Yeah.
And obviously, thanks to all my coaches, my teammates at ASW, Big Darren Morris, that's taught me everything he knows. Well, three quarters probably, because he always kicks my ass. And me family, my girlfriend, my kids for supporting me. So, one more time, big thanks to Forge Fitness, my boxing coach, Gaz, at Forge Fitness. He looks after me a lot.
Good lad. All the best.
Thanks a lot, brother. Nice speaking to you. Thanks a lot.
Take care, mate. Speak to you.
Take it easy. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Cheers to Lee. What a gent. And good luck to him on fight night. Next up, the Vikings are in town as we chat with the main event, Denmark's own Soren
Liverpool Saturday. I'm pleased to say we're joined at this time by the main event, the true Viking, Soren Back. Soren, how are you, sir?
Hello, I'm great.
It's great to have you on. And before actually we look ahead to all things Liverpool, because I mean you've kind of kicked the door down here. You've took scalps, my friend. You've really done fantastic. Scott Cliss, the Stapleton one was a big one. For us, we were like, wow, who's this guy? You finished off Jacobson. That was probably one of the bloodiest battles Cage Warriors seen. But maybe for those unfamiliar to you and your career, if you let our listeners know, talk a wee bit about your journey from your early MMA into your fantastic rise here in Cage Warriors.
Yeah, thank you. So I've been a wrestler all my life, and when I was 15, they started an MMA team right after my wrestling class was over. And my trainer just said, you got to go there. So I did. And when I turned 18, I started my first amateur MMA fight. And actually, a few weeks later, I was called in like last minute to a semi-pro fight. And it was kind of off from there.
Wow.
Fighting mostly in Denmark at the time. And then into Finland. And after that, to Cage Warriors.
I mean, it just seems like it's went, correct me if I'm wrong, it seems like it's went so fast for you, your MMA career and martial arts in general.
Yeah, I'm kind of atypical in the way that most guys have a lot of amateur fights and then they go pro.
Yeah.
But I was kind of shanghaied into taking that semi-pro fight right after my first debut. And it went great. And but you kind of really go back from there to amateur, so... I think I had had one amateur fight after that, because the guy I was facing, he has also tried himself at pro fighting, and
I see.
He wanted to go back at amateur as well. So we tried that and won that as well. So from there, it was just pro fights. So as long as everything goes great, if you kind of leap ahead, it makes sense that things go faster.
Oh, absolutely, and not to be Debbie Downer, not to be too down, but coming into Cage Warriors, if I understand right, you were actually coming off your first loss in your professional career. Is that correct?
That's true.
I mean, what a way to bounce back, my friend. You've done amazing. But I mean, was that playing on your mind making your Cage Warriors debut?
Well, not really, because I wasn't really hurt in the fight I lost. I was dropped twice in a short span of time. And so the referee just stepped in and stopped the fight. But I was back at training the day after. So at the time, we didn't really agree with the decision. But the referee is there to protect us. So yeah, that's that.
Fair play. Going into the Stapleton fight in particular, that's the first time I think I set eyes on you. We followed Martin Stapleton here. We've had him on our podcast a couple of times for Bama shows, and to us, like I said, man, that was a complete shock. But I hope Martin doesn't mind me saying this. You made it look pretty easy, like getting it done in the first round. Amazing, man. What do you remember from that fight?
Yes, we figured that he was trying to, he would try to keep the distance and outbox me.
Mm-hmm.
That seems like it was the obvious thing to do, but he had said previously that he thought he could hang with me in the wrestling and grappling department, so mm-hmm. that might have been why he closed in so fast,
yeah.
Because he's actually the one getting into me, and then we kind of scrambles and I get up on top.
Mm-hmm.
From there, when I get the back, it's really hard to get me off.
yeah.
And I'm just going to pound the elbows until I find the submission.
Fair play, mate. And Jacobson fight as well, as we mentioned. A pretty bloody affair. Is that one of the bloodiest fights you've been involved in, or has there been worse in your career?
Yeah, rewatching the fights, at the time I thought maybe Scott Cliff bled just as much, but he didn't really. But his blonde hair got all red in my debut in Cage Warriors. But
yeah,
man, Jacobson, he could bleed.
Yeah, for sure, the blonde hair, that's hilarious. Fair play, mate. Just one of the wee things we were speaking to prior to the show was Cage Warriors have announced Cage Warriors Academy in Denmark. I'm not too clued up on it, but like I said, it is sort of new and recent news. Soren, tell me your thoughts on some of this and some of the scene. What's MMA like where you come from in Denmark? How do you rate it?
Yeah, so Cage Warriors coming to Denmark, even in a bit smaller capacity, is a great thing for Danish MMA, because we only really at the time right now have few local event makers, a few trying to make a bigger impact, but it's kind of small scale shows. So just Cage Warriors bringing it back to Denmark is a great thing, and they just announced this companionship with Mark the Olympian Madsen. Olympic medalist in Greco-Roman wrestling,
right?
And he's kind of making the move into MMA now and wants to go to the UFC. So kudos to him, and I hope the best for him.
Yeah, us too. Fair play. Well, you get your wish. You get to fight Paddy Pimblett for the title. It's his hometown of Liverpool. This fighting in his backyard. Does that worry you at all, mate?
No. I realize that it's going to be loud and probably maybe some beer throwing or something. But as long as it's only beer, I'm cool with it.
Yeah, that's it.
No, because, well, when I fought Martin Stapleton, it was also in Liverpool,
right.
And Manchester's quite close by. So he had a lot of support as well, not nearly as much as the whole arena, which Paddy's going to have. And maybe I've reserved a small corner for my fans, so hopefully I can hear them still. But yeah, it's not something that I really think a lot about, because all my fights in outside of Denmark has been like that. My first fight in Finland against Alexi Nurminen is like a rock star over there.
Wow, right. What was that experience like?
It was kind of my first experience in that regard, and it was a bit intimidating, but the Finnish fight fans, they are really well educated, so
yes,
when they see a good fight, they cheer both fighters.
Yeah. I mean, Paddy Pimblett is probably the most famous guy in the UK, maybe outside the UFC, but aside from popularity and all that, just how do you rate him as a fighter? How do you rate his game and his style, and so to speak?
So Paddy is really hard to like pin down, because he's so awkward in everything he does. And even when I went over to Liverpool to do some promos with him, he was like, yeah, nobody can imitate me. that's just about right.
Yeah.
But he has a strong base in almost every aspect of the sport. So what I do to prepare is just I find the best guys available in both grappling, wrestling, and striking departments, and just polish up my game there.
Yeah, and imagine you'll be well prepared. And the Vikings are coming. This is what I read a lot from your followers.
Yeah.
As someone from Denmark fighting in the European scene, You know, you've sort of told us a bit of your early days and things like that coming from your neck of the woods, but you're getting a title shot now. How much does this mean to you fighting for the Cage Warriors title, and how do you think things will change if you get that victory, my friend?
Yeah, so it's a really big step, and it's what we've been searching for since we went to Cage Warriors.
Right.
Even after my first fight, I was kind of calling out because people had talked about Scott Cliss being a contender if he hadn't lost the fight. So I figured just might as well plow on. And taking out the top of the division, now Fish goes off to UFC. So it seems obvious. And Paddy starting calling me out, right back at him. And now we're here. So I'm just hoping that getting this title will propel me towards my ultimate goal of going to the UFC.
That's incredible. Good for you, sir. Soren Back, a massive thank you for your time on the show today. Before I let you go, I just want to allow you the chance to shout out or acknowledge any sponsors or associates, affiliates, friends, teammates, family, anyone you like, sir. The floor is yours.
Yeah, thank you. So big shout out to my wife. It was in this time training up to the fight. She's kind of been providing for the family at home here. Also to my friends and family, Scott, coming to the show and supporting me in that way, my team for being there every day, and Carsten Etrup, my trainer. Also, the sponsors, Pride of Die sponsors my shirts, and did a contract with Feel Supreme for supplements. Also got Nutramino and Nippon Sports. They secure all my equipment. So thank you a lot, guys.
Awesome stuff. Soren Back, thank you again for your time. Best of luck in Liverpool, my friend. We'll catch up post-fight.
Thank you.
Cheers to Soren. Can't wait for this fight, and I can't wait for you all to hear what Paddy had to say. So here he is, Liverpool's son, Paddy, the Baddy. Liverpool. I'm pleased to see joining us at this time, Liverpool's greatest son, the Baddy, Paddy Pimblett. Paddy, how you doing, sir?
What's happening, how are we? I'm good. Hope you are.
Pleasure to have you on, mate. Actually, before I chat about Soren and Cage Warriors, just fair play to you, mate, because I've heard you speak about this a couple of times in interviews, you know, with the UFC coming calling, folk are asking, why is he not making the jump, why is it this, that and the other. You're making a point, mate. Yeah, you're just saying no, you want to test yourself with the best.
Yeah, people, talk to people ever go on about when it comes to the UFC, there's more to MMA than the UFC. It's like people running around shouting the Barclays Premier League, the Barclays.
Aye. Yeah.
It's not. That's just an organisation. It's not the actual sport. There's more to it than that.
That's it, mate. Definitely. And turning down UFC Liverpool as well, I heard that you remember that was the case. Is that true, mate?
Yeah, it's one of them, innit? I was in New York at the time and I got the phone call. Still had an injured wrist, and I was in New York training. Like, I had an injured wrist, I didn't know what was actually up with my wrist when I got home. I ended up finding out there was a broken bone in it, so it was a good job that I never really. But I got told you want to fight in it and that, but I've said it before, I'll say it again. I got told fight on this, and there's no cage while he's in the Echo Arena.
No,
that what? And he was like, yeah, it doesn't get booked without you. That, so I was just like, well, I'm not just thinking about myself.
Aye.
I'm thinking about the rest of next gen, the rest of the Scouse fighters, everyone else, that all the amateurs that get the opportunity to fight on such a big show. Know what I mean?
Yeah, no, definitely. Fair play to you, mate. You're a man of the people for sure. You were out in New York, you said. Where was that? Were you at Henzo's?
Yeah, it was at Enzo's. Unbelievable.
Yeah, man. Tell us what's it like. Is he crazy or what?
That's bad. The blue basement, man. It's a belter. Blue basement. Everyone's sad in there as well. There's no knobheads. Anyone that's a knobhead in there just gets told to fuck off.
Yeah, man.
It's a boss little atmosphere in there. Everyone's sad. They've got to roll with some very good people as well. Some of the best in the world.
That's it, mate. Oh, it's class. We spoke to Soren earlier this weekend, and I'm sure, you know, you've had your sit down Zoom and all the rest of it. He's fond of your style, mate. He's fond of how you bring it. He's excited for the test. Some people in the media, they're calling it wrestling versus jiu-jitsu. What's your thoughts on how this is going down, mate?
It's not unlike that. It's not wrestling versus jiu-jitsu. This is an MMA fighter versus an MMA fighter.
Aye.
That's what this is. You know what I mean? It's not a wrestling versus jiu-jitsu. We both do jiu-jitsu, wrestling, and striking every day. You know what I mean? It's not one style versus another style. I know I'm a good wrestler. I know Soren's a good wrestler. I know I'm good at jiu-jitsu. I know Soren's good at jiu-jitsu. He's nowhere near as good as me, but I know he can. He's good at jiu-jitsu, you know what I mean?
And
the biggest golfing difference, I think, in this fight is how bad his striking is compared to mine.
Tell us, you don't rate it?
No, he's got an overhand right. I'll dance around him.
And I know what you're saying about that style matchup. I mean, I've watched your career for a while, mate. It pisses me off when folk pigeonhole fighters like this. Oh, he's a jiu-jitsu guy. You know what I mean? It's just like, he's all so clued up in all facets of the game. But those days are over as far as I'm concerned, this style versus that style.
I know, yeah, you can't just be a jiu-jitsu guy in this sport no more. Just like you can't just be a wrestler. You get found out. Styles make fights.
Yep.
I could beat Soren, and someone could beat me, and then he could beat them.
Yep.
That's what MMA's like. It's like triangles, know what I mean?
Yeah.
Seen it happen in weight divisions. It's just like bantamweight. Cruz got beat by Garbrandt. Garbrandt got beat by Dillashaw, and Cruz beat Dillashaw.
Yeah.
Styles make fights.
Absolutely.
It's not about stuff like that. MMA, you can't stay unbeaten.
Absolutely not. That's the reality of it. Fair play, mate. We spoke about your assessment of Soren and his overhand rate. But he doesn't seem fazed about fighting in your backyard. I mean, it may be different on fighting, of course, but do you think this will... I mean, obviously, Liverpool's going to be giving you the hometown support and all the rest of it, but you think that's the same football? It's like the you know, the 12th man. That makes a difference to how you perform?
I know what you're saying there, like, but... I know what he's saying. He's fought here before. He's never fought a Scouser here before. He fought States here, which is a different ball game. But I know what he means. He doesn't generally fight in his own backyard. So yeah, he is going to be used to it, isn't he? Know what I mean? It's not an out of the ordinary for him. He's fought all over the gaff. So I understand what he's saying there. It probably won't phase him the fact he's coming to Liverpool. I'll give him that.
Yeah, fair play, mate. He's calling for a second round knockout, that's what he told us. You're a guy who's never been finished. Give us your thoughts on that comment, mate.
It's not happening, is it? You know what I mean? You can't. It's just, I'm not even going to like sit here and talk about that question because it's not going to happen.
Definitely not.
You know what I mean? It's just
doesn't come into your thoughts. Aye.
No, that's just him and his dreams. You know what I mean? I know everyone's dreams of beating me, lad, but fuck. Nad's aim to beat me, lad. He could only get it done by decision.
Is it, mate? I guess there's a wee bit of friendly banter and a build-up as well. We saw that tweet at Real Madrid top. I imagine the reaction from the faithful and the echo is going to make a lot of noise as well, man. He's bringing the heat.
Yeah, it is like he's not coming in at the right way to please the fans. Like, I'll be honest, before and I've fought people and stuff, it's been hostile and stuff like that. I mean, like me and Son have just been having bits of banter.
Aye.
You know what I mean?
Aye. Oh, it's like good
even,
to see.
Even yesterday, I put on me. Did you see me Insta story yesterday?
I didn't know. Close up.
Put a thing on me Insta story yesterday saying, someone from Sweden had messaged me saying, I hope you beat Son up and that. And I just messaged out like a screenshot there and put it on the story. See Soren, even people from Baddy don't want you to win.
The Vikings are defeated, it sounds like, eh?
He messaged me back saying, Sweden and Denmark hate each other, my friend. And we was just putting laughs to each other. I was just like, I've just got a little history lesson there. Nice one, Soren.
Class. Echo main event. We spoke a wee bit about you're enjoying life as 55. No more cut to featherweight. Is that journey done and dusted for you then?
I don't know at the minute, to be honest. Because I went and done like DEXA scans and stuff like that with the uni.
Mm-hmm.
And I think they said to me that it's unhealthy for me to go back down to that weight.
Right.
Because they said even my bones went dense and everything. Like, my bones went smaller off getting down to featherweight and all sorts like that. Like, they'd never seen nothing like it. They said, like, I'm proper killing my body going down to that weight.
Yeah, doesn't sound like it's advisable. But you're a guy who's been 45, you know, most of your career. You always felt good, though, doing that cut? Or was it really tough for you to make featherweight?
No, it got worse and worse.
Aye.
Like, it worse and worse every time. No, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, at first I started out as a bantamweight, didn't I?
35, yep, uh-huh. And so that's...
Started out as a bantamweight, and then I just, obviously, my first fight, I was only 16. So obviously I was never staying at Bantamweight.
Sure.
Like,
aye, aye.
But a few pro fight I think I missed Bantam. Missed Bantam and I fought Conrad Hayes by a lot and just got told I can't fight at Bantam again because I missed it by a good few pounds. Mm-hmm. And then after that, Meekin said it was easy.
Mm-hmm.
And then I missed weight before I fought for the belt. For the featherweight belt, and I was looking moving up after that. And then obviously Alex Enlin got signed and the belt became vacant and I could fight for the belt, so that happened. And then I killed myself another few times to make featherweight to defend the belt.
Aye, man. Sounds tough.
Killing myself to make the weight. Yeah. My performance is hindered, know what I mean? And mm-hmm, I still went five rounds twice, even after cutting all that weight. Yeah. But my performance was hindered both times. Yeah. So we come to the smart decision that lightweight was the best for future.
Aye.
And like doing them DEXA scans and stuff with the uni, they said like it's very unhealthy for me to go back down to featherweight. Like
mm-hmm,
me insides were going smaller, you know what I mean? Like aye, my bones, my skull, stuff like that was going smaller because I was losing that much weight.
Yeah, it's a dangerous old game already as it is. You don't want to make things worse.
I just put it into perspective like this. When I fought you, Julian and Rosa, I lost 8.3 kilograms overnight.
Oh, God. Jesus.
When I fought Nad, I lost 7.7 kilograms overnight. And what are we, 12 days away from the weigh-in?
Uh-huh.
And I woke up 75 kg dead.
Here you go. Yeah, that tells you all you need to know, right?
Yeah. And I've got to wake up at 70.3
yeah,
in 12 days.
Yeah, yeah.
You know what I mean? It just puts in to perspective, but at the same time, I think it puts a bit into perspective that I wasn't being as professional then, know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
I was 21, I was on top of the world, I had loads of Klingons around me, fucking going out partying all the time, and weighing 100% switched on to this, and now I am, know what I mean? Now it's a lot different. Yeah, when I fought the Rose, it was like a 60% me,
uh-huh,
maybe not even that, know what I mean?
Yeah.
Now, when people fight me, it's 100% me.
Yeah.
They're not ready, know what I mean?
Yeah.
Actually diet and properly have trained hard, you know what I mean?
This is it. I mean, it's like you evolve in all aspects of the game in MMA, but things outside as well, a professional approach, and it sounds like, you know, it's just making life a heck of a lot easier for you, you know, everything
yeah,
else is just taking care of
being more professional, dude. It's made everything 10 times easier for me, you know what I mean?
Aye.
Just listening to the people around me more, not thinking I'm a know-it-all, listening to me coach, listening yeah, to me dad, listening to me family, listen to my teammates, you know what I mean? They yeah, know better than I do, but when you're a kid, you think you're fucking, you know, fucking
but that's what's got you here in the first place as well, though, so don't put young Paddy down, man. We love young Paddy as well.
I know, like, I hated him. Like, obviously, I hate that mad fight, you know what I mean? So
yeah,
I lost in front of my own fans and that, yeah, but looking back now, if it wasn't for losing that fight, I wouldn't be the man I am now.
Exactly, mate. It's made you who you
are. I look back at that fight now as a blessing in disguise because I think that was a close fight. Don't care what anyone says, that was a close
mm-hmm,
fight. It's 2-2 to me or not. But I think it was fate why I lost that decision because mm-hmm, I needed it at the time.
That's a good way to look at it, mate. Yeah, positive attitude. Pazia, a pleasure for your time. I've just got one or two things before I wrap up.
Oh, what do you like? Crack one of you on some. It's helping me pass time. I'm happy.
Well, I'm nervous about this next one, but I've got to ask it anyway because we've had him on the podcast a couple of times. Your name always comes up in conversation. You probably know who I'm going to say. Brendan Loughlin.
Okay, now.
Will we ever get to see that Manchester-Liverpool derby, mate?
If he wants to step up, he'll get to Manchester-Liverpool derby. I'm quite sick of getting asked about it, to be fair. it's like, really though, it's not on me, lad. He starts popping up and saying stuff about me when I get a fight confirmed, you know what I mean? He never says nothing when I haven't got an opponent confirmed. He never says nothing when, like, I'm just there, you know what I mean? And
mm-hmm,
we could get negotiations on the go.
Mm-hmm.
As soon as I get a fight booked and it's getting put up places, he starts jumping on. Oh, he didn't want to fight me, did he? Because you never fucking asked. Stupid twat. You know what I mean? You're popping up saying stuff now that you know that I've got a fight. And you know that you can't. And that I'm like, I'm fully booked, so you can't fight me. That's what he does. He does it for publicity.
You don't think he wants to fight? You don't think he actually wants it then?
No, he doesn't fancy it.
Don't fancy it.
He doesn't fancy it. He goes on like he fancies it. He doesn't fancy it. You just fancy, like, I don't mind Brendan, know what I mean? He's a good fighter and he's arse. He can be signed, but he's not trying to fucking use my name to get fucking publicity.
Yeah, yeah.
But he needs to fucking get Dominic Cruz's balls out of his mouth.
Same fair, mate. I hope
even
it does happen.
He even got told he could have done that featherweight tournament, I think. Well, he got told he could have fought for the featherweight belt on Cage Warriors, and then when I do beat back, if he won that belt, we could have a champion versus champion fight.
Mm-hmm.
But he's a fucking bitch. Think about it, lad. He goes on like, it's me. He tries to like tell people it's me who turned it down. Lad, I, the contract was there. I signed it.
Mm-hmm.
I was ready to go. After I beat him. Who was it?
ACB, wasn't it? Was it running about
there? No, after I beat Frazier.
Oh, was it one attack?
I'd signed the Cage Warriors contract with Brendan. Was saying he was going to come to Cage Warriors.
Right.
I said to Paul, I want to fight him. Said to Graham, I want to fight him.
Mm-hmm.
Let's get it on. And then it all went to fuck. You signed for ACB. You signed a league what fucking promotes fucking slavery and that. Fucking hell, drop a gang of Russian drug lords, buddy, when I found him instead of stupid cunt. Paid his money in euros in a shoebox, the fucking fella.
It just makes me want to see it even more. This is tremendous. But you're all for it, you're just waiting for a yes, and it's never happened, right? That's the story.
No, I'm just waiting for a yes, and then yeah. There's been occasions where he's just messaged Graham off the blue and being like, oh, I'm ready to sign for Cage Warriors, I want to get this Paddy fight done. And then every single time they get it, like, it's not Graham who stalls the talks,
mm-hmm.
It's Brendan. Brendan's like, oh, yeah, signed, I'll get back to you. And then it doesn't happen, he doesn't get back to him. He just blanks him and then signs the fight some fella who's shit, and then goes on about beating him with a broken arm, even though the fella was shit anyway. But I swear that kid who beat last time with a broken arm, I reckon fucking me 12-year-old nephew would beat him.
So you got skills, your nephew, you know, right? I
mean? No, he's a little fat. That's what I mean. A little bit, but he can't even fight that. That's how bad that opponent was.
Job easing out of the office then for you? Is that fair to say? If you and Brendan there go there?
Yeah, I really reckon it'd be easy night at the office for him. He thinks he's fucking, oh listen, that lad, he thinks he's got fucking striking like fucking Dwayne Ludwig, just being there, and TJ's throwing all his bits, got alright striking. But for now, like I said, he's defo got fucking Dominic Cruz's balls in his mouth. That's why he's all
he's there. That's tremendous,
eh? I've fucking seen Dominic Cruz with a woman, lad. When we ever seen him holding Brendan's hand?
I still want to see this fight probably more so than ever now after this chat. That's tremendous, mate. We've got Liverpool obviously in full voice, your crowd, September 1st, fighting in front of your home fans. You've probably been asked a million times, mate, but they adore you, they absolutely adore you. What does it mean fighting in front of the Liverpool faithful to you?
There's nothing better, you know what I mean? Like, really, when I walk out into that crowd, there's no feeling like it. Like, no feeling like it. Serious stuff.
Just the ultimate like, buzz.
Yeah, like, I swear, when I walk out and I just look around and I can see everyone and just looking around, like, oh my God, this is unbelievable. And, like, I'll be honest, last time I was a bit nervous. Never been, I can't remember the last time I was nervous. Last time I was a little bit nervous, obviously. Before that fight, I was going into the fight with a 9-fight win streak. And then I lost, and then I was meant to fight in October. I got told I couldn't fight then, so there was a lot riding on that last fight, I'll be honest. I thought, fucking hell, that last fight, if I don't win this fight, my career's over.
Right. Wow. That's how you felt about it, right? You thought your career would be over? Big pressure?
Yeah. You know what I mean? I've never felt pressure before, and I felt it last time.
Yeah, yeah. And you certainly, you do well with these performances, are absolutely outstanding. Paddy, you're Liverpool's son, and a lot of fans in Scotland love you as well, including myself. Before I let you go, though...
Lad, I've said this before, lad, the same.
Oh, tell us you're coming here. You're coming north of the border, right? Come on, then.
The jocks are them, and the Paddies are the most like us, lad. We're more like jocks than anyone else in England, lad.
It's a Celtic connection, that's what it is, man.
It's, lad, it is, definitely. I hate the rest of England, me, lad. All the jobs
are fucking Cracking, lad. Before I let you go, just want to give you a chance to shout out sponsors, associates, families, friends, anyone you like, sir. The floor is yours.
Well, yeah, the main the main people I'd like to thank is my family, my mum, my dad, my coaches, know what I mean? Ellis, my coach, and my mate, all my teammates. And you know what, I need to thank all the professional amateurs in the gym. Like, just all the amateurs just get looked past, know what I mean? Like, listen, the amateurs in our gym, saying like pros, these far like pros.
Yeah.
Like, half of my fight camp, I've been getting ready with the amateurs because they're that professional and they're that good, know what I mean?
Yeah.
Our amateurs could go into most pro shows and beat most pros up. So I need to say thank you to them, and then all my sponsors, obviously, know what I mean? To Shooty, Goodness Grill, SA Nutrition, ISO Sport, Scramble, I'm bad at this, as you can tell.
You get so many to thank, that's it, mate.
I lad, they all go. As soon as someone says, oh yeah, what's your sponsors? You all just vanish. Like,
yeah, that's
every
it.
Every one of them, you like that? Oh,
fair play, mate. Paddy the Baddy Pimblett, all the best for Cage Warriors 96, sir, and good luck at the Echo. See you in Liverpool, my friend.
Nice one.
Thanks to Paddy, to Lee and to Soren for their time on the show. Cage Warriors 96 set to be a cracking night of fights at the Echo this Saturday, and you can check it out on BT Sport here in the UK, and it'll be also available around the world on UFC Fight Pass as well. Just a quick reminder that our 100th episode will take place a week on Sunday. It will be answering all your fan questions and comments live here on the show. Send us whatever you like. You've got a chance to win some prizes, courtesy of our friends at bscare.co.uk. Until then, I'm John Boy McElroy. I'll catch you next time on the Martial Arts Chat Podcast. Change your heart.